Good morning. Welcome to this workshop. Our workshop is talking about innovation in elderly care. Hope you come to the right room. Yes? Okay, no one. Okay, I think you make the right decision from my perspective for social innovation and social entrepreneurship. A lot of money, capital go into environmental related enterprise. But personally, I believe elderly care is the second biggest challenge facing human society. And there will be a lot of development and huge, huge opportunity as, of course, as well as a big social problem that we have to address. Today, we have the honor to have three top scholars from Japan, from Korea, and from China to share with us their experience in innovating, observing innovation from the different countries. I think whenever we go into elderly care, we have two concepts we really need to understand thoroughly before we could succeed in this area. First is the understanding of the nature of elderly care. As mentioned by Professor Prestoff right at the opening speech, he talked about co-production. And elderly care is really one of the key examples of co-production, because the client, they want the care in a specific way. It's very difficult to standardize what they want, and then they have a lot of input also. And the second concept our speaker will also touch on is elderly care market as a common pool resource. This is a service you could not exclude most of the citizens. You have to provide. Also with a lot of public money going in. So without understanding the role of public finance and social economy, just treating it as as one of the private market, then it's difficult. But without further ado, let me introduce Ms. Chen first. Ms. Chen is a lawyer by training and practice. Also a manager, a lecturer, and an insurance agent. I don't know how she could do so many things in such a young age. But she is going to share with us her thesis on how to extend the Uber model, the sharing economy concept to elderly care. Ms. Chen, may I invite you? Oh, by the way, every speaker will have 50 minutes to present, and then we hopefully have 30 minutes left, and I really want a heated debate, discussion, so yeah, be ready for your opinion and also questions, okay, afterward. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's my honor to come here and share with you it's a concept study. It's not yet go to the field, and I'm given to know there's some practice in Hong Kong. So if any of you happen to apply the Uber model in elderly care in Hong Kong, would like you to share more with me so we can study together. Yeah, thank you. This is about my thinking whether elderly care can go Uber. We're given a brief background, the supply and demand in elderly care in China, and explain a little bit about what is the Uber model. And the Uber model in confront of three issues we identify which concern the elderly care sector. And we come to conclusion. So the background, the demand side, I think I don't need to talk too much. We are all experiencing it. I think just one point worth mentioning. In Chinese society, many elderly and their family would prefer home care instead of the institution care. And the supply side, from several surveys, we identified three problems. Workforce, the dearth of quality care worker. This concerns both the quality and the quantity of the workforce. And secondly, the financing. Many have experiencing the rigid in funding and also the policy problem. And the other side, we're seeing the Uber hit. Some scholars even predict there's an Uber or in the future, Uber or economy. And some says if you don't have an APP in the future, you'll have the disadvantage. So what is Uber model? From the literature review, we find there's no solid definition. It is often discussed associated with many other terms like sharing economy, collaborative consumption, and firms may consider digital matching firm, etc. If we look at the narrow sense, Uber is here. It's a for-profit P2P business. But if we zoom out a little bit, it could be embracing both non-profit and for-profit. It could be P2P or B2C. So Uber is an internet of things. It is capable in a swift matching of supply and demand, and its great potential is to activate those under leverage source asset service. My study is in the crossover area between elderly care and the Uber business, or the so-called share economy. We have identified three main problems concerning elderly care sectors, and the following part we will examine one by one. What's the potential of the Uber model in elderly care sector? Workforce. We look at Uber, this is the data of Uber. You can see a fast growth of the workforce in quantity. They are very successful in attracting new blood. And we find more than half of the new joiner have never had the earning experience in driving before. So this is the pure new blood to the industry. And they are from all walks of life. We'll consider whether they are the potential in elderly care sector we can explore. For example, the retired, the unemployed, the stay-at-home people or students, whether we can group them together and do the cooperation. And we find Uber model have successfully changed the driver's profile. A survey indicate that Uber driver are younger, better educated, and from a diverse background. So this shows the Uber driver partners indeed from a very diverse background in terms of the industry before Uber and the job category before Uber. In the sum up, the workforce are motivated by Uber mainly of two things. Financial drive, of course, and work autonomy. Uber apply a light labor model. They treat them as independent contractors instead of employee. This is a rather controversial point, but Uber claimed that this is their success factor. And the winner's high satisfaction rate from the driver partners. So Uber model is capable in building the supply side, which is one of the main concerns of our elderly care. They increase the quantity enhance the quality and the workforce satisfaction. We'll ask whether this is applicable to other sectors. And from some examples, the answer seems yes. Next issue is financing. Here are some examples. The first two are the ride share, and 3 to 5 are tech startup in the US on the home elderly care service. They all look doing quite good in the financing job. The common features of these examples, they are all venture funded, for-profit startup. They mainly live in the investor's capital. They need the capital injection to doing their marketing and price war, etc. And the valuation are sparing high while the profitability is uncertain. Let's look at Uber as example. The valuation increase rapidly after each injection of the capital. But we take Uber China, for example. The valuation is $7 billion by August of 2015 before they merge, 2016, before they merge with Didi Chuxing, another top share rider in China. But Uber China is not making money. They were at loss $1 billion each year, but they value $7 billion. So there's a question whether there's a bubble. Some scholars predict the bubble is to burst immediately. And the merge between Didi Chuxing and Uber China is a sign of the burst of the bubble. This is a hint of the capital market is turning cold. Whether the new tech that startup can continue to sell this idea and getting the capital injection, that's in question. So in financing part, we capture some facts. Financing is a main constraint to elderly care sector. The Uber model seems doing quite good so far, but the capital market is chilling. And the prevailing market logic is winner takes all. Whether this financing model is applicable to elderly care sector is a question. The question is whether this fascinating concept can continue to sell itself under the current market situation, and whether the predator Uber-specific way suit for elderly care, and whether other hybrid models of in financing can kick in and do the work. How shall Uberized elderly care compete in the market with the government subsidized service? That's a big question for the for-profit operation. Policy. We have seen policy become the most significant risk to all the Uber-like firms. But on the other hand, we find the popularity and the influence of the Uber-like model. They have urged the government to review their policy and regulations. This gives some hope for the regulation integration. Like what it has happening in China is there is an interim guideline issued last month. And this happened very quickly because the impact of the Didi and Uber in China. So in sum up, we do an assessment of this Uber model in confront of the three key issues we identify. And we find in respect of human resources, the probability of solving this problem by applying the Uber model is pretty high. In respect of the policy and regulation consistency, it's a medium probability. But financing, we have a big doubt. whether the for-profit predative financing model like Uber is doing, whether they fit to the elderly care service sector. We come to conclusion. Internet Plus is a catchword in China now. It's internet plus some traditional industry operation. It's a trend. The important question is not just seeing the downside of this model, but to clarify what's our value and what's the trade-off. Uber model, in my personal view, has a good potential in elderly home care services, but it requires more strategic consideration. Not just the APP can secure success. We need a more strategic thought in each specific institution context. And we have some worry notes to practitioner. Maybe we can leave it later. I think I'm running out of time. It's okay. Right, so we can leave it to the discussion. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we will have the Q&A session after all the presentation from our speakers. Ms. Chen suggests three areas that Uber model might apply in the elderly care sectors. First is the workers, the workforce. The second is the policy. The third is finance. So the workers, she believes it will create a lot more supply, solving this lack of labor in elderly care. And financing, hopefully some private equity VC guy jump in and give a lot of money. Whether this is applicable, you will voice out your opinion in our discussion session. And of course, policy is always a big issue. It actually shapes our whole industry, depend on what type of policy address adopted by the government. I think at the core of this innovative idea is the share information platform. Whoever successfully establishes it will impact the whole ecosystem of elderly care. Yeah. So if all the needs we can see and all the supply we can identify and they can automatically match each other, that will be wonderful, no matter whether it's elderly care or a medical service. So I look forward to hear your input and comment on that. Next speaker we have is Professor Kurimoto-san. Professor Kurimoto is working at the Institute of Solidarity-Based Society at Hosei University. He's the chair of International Cooperative Alliance. Professor Pestov this morning mentioned a lot about this social and solidarity economy and co-production with the expertise from Professor Kurimoto. Let's hear more about his suggestion and his talk on this aspect. Thank you. Without further ado, may I have the honor to invite Professor?
Dear friends, many thanks for your introduction, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to go to speak about social innovation in the cooperative elderly care in Japan. First of all, I came from the background of the consumer cooperatives, which is not so familiar to most of the Hong Kong people. That is developed amongst the consumers as a kind of the buying clubs in the United States or in Canada. But we had developed a very large network of the consumers to buy produce, food and produce in a group. That is a collective enterprise of consumers. And we cover about half of households in Japan. But this consumer cooperatives also covers the healthcare and social care. So I shall deal with this in this presentation. I shall first describe the context of reform of social welfare policy for the elderly, because institutions matter in the healthcare and elderly care. And now, secondly, I shall deal with the increased competition among the providers for elderly care. Thirdly, very briefly, I shall describe the typology of the cooperative providers of the elderly care. Then I shall concentrate on the health cooperatives' involvement in the elderly care. Then I shall take the case of Minami Medical Corp, located in Nagoya, in the central part of Japan, its involvement in the elderly care, and that leads to the conclusion. The context is a very rapid aging population poses challenges for the social welfare system, and quasi-market reform in social care policy is taking place, and the introduction of the long-term care insurance, LTCI, in the year 2000. You can see now the Japanese elderly care, elderly population is more than 27% of the total population. That is highest and very rapidly increasing. That will be followed by Korea and then China because of the single child policy. It will become very really challenge for Chinese, mainland China, including Hong Kong, how to deal with the elderly population. And you can see here on the right, sorry. You can see here the ratio of the elderly population among to the elder labor force. Japan is now more than 40%, and in the year in 4 years it will rise to 55%. So it means that two working persons support one elderly. And you can see the number of elderly suffered from dementia is increasing very rapidly, and it will increase in the coming years. And so the quasi-market reform in social welfare policy had been sought since 1990. And then long-term care insurance law was enacted in 1997. Taking the model from Germany. The underlying principles of reform is that the generalization of welfare services from government-sponsored very selective care to more universal service to everyone, and user-oriented mechanisms and improved service quality, and municipality-centered mechanism, and normalization by improving in-home services is given the focus. And the multi-dimensional system for providing services, not only the government, but also private sector and the third sector. And the cooperation among health promotion, medical care, and social care is very important issue. You can see this is long-term care insurance system, which is financed by the social insurance, 90%, sorry, 45%, tax 45%, and 10% by the co-payments by the people. You can see the challenge in number of long-term care service users, it's increasing very rapidly. Now more than 4 million people is receiving the services, and it is more problematic if we look at the finance. It is now surpassing 1 trillion yen. So the sustainability of long-term care system is questioned because of success of this scheme. So now the Ministry of Health and Labor and Welfare seeks to build the integrated community care system by the year 2025, when the baby boomer generation, including myself, turns 75 years old or more. This generation will need more personal care and medical care. And integrated community care is a network of entities that provides housing, medical care, long-term care, prevention services, and livelihood support in an integrated manner in communities. ICC assumes an approximate range of a junior high school district as a space of network. It aims to enable people to continue to live in their hometowns to the end of their lives with a sense of security once they are in severe need of long-term care. ICC needs to be created by municipalities based on the independent and original ideas of the community concerned and according to its characteristics. And ministry encourage initiatives for ICC, but without any financial back. That is a problem. So now I shall come to the increased competition among elderly care providers. In the past, only municipalities and social welfare corporation, that is quasi NGO, are responsible and can provide the elderly care. But now, everyone can do the elderly care. So now the nonprofit sector maintaining its share in services in facilities. Still, social welfare corporation are now dominating in this sector. And for-profit sector making aggressive expansion, focusing on the services, generating higher profits. For instance, nursing home on the private financing. The corporate sector is holding minor share in this provision of services. You can see this is a shell number of service providers. You can see the non-profits is for the institutional care, still social welfare corporations has a lion's share. You can see here, yes, special elderly nursing home. And health facility for the elderly, the medical corporations have a very high share as an extension of health care. So now I come to the cooperatives. There are many, some kinds of the cooperatives which are providing the social care or elderly care designated under the long-term care insurance system, health corps and consumer cooperatives, agriculture cooperatives, and COSERN, that is a specified organization for medical care, and workers' cooperatives, and social welfare corporations set up by cooperatives, because only social welfare corporations can operate the nursing homes. So you can see the figures. Now I come to health corps or medical corps. Health corps are organized by consumers and registered by the Consumer Cooperative Act. And so they are classified as user-owned by the UN survey on the health and social corps. A majority of members are users, 99% are consumers, but medical professionals like doctors, nurses are also allowed membership. Nearly 3 million members in 115 cooperatives in 40 provinces. A bulk of members seems to be 60 plus. And 35,000 employees, including doctors, nurses, care workers, are also members. There are four characteristics of health corps. It's a medical institution that is primarily composed of healthy people. So this is different from the, patients' associations. It places emphasis on health promotion and system to secure it. It has clinical facilities, hospitals, clinics, that secure users' participation in health care. It has Han groups. Han or Pan in Chinese means the small unit of the organizations, composed of 10 or 15 members, where members can participate as a principal. HealthCorp's health promotion is very characteristic. It promoted members learning about health promotion in hand groups and lectures and courses. It encouraged members' self-monitoring of health conditions in hand groups through self-monitoring and keeping records. For instance, measuring blood pressure, sugar and salt contents in urine, fat contents, etc., using simple devices. And it trained voluntary health advisors as a driving force for health promotion. Now, 30,000 members are registered as health volunteers. And these activities are coordinated by branch committees. And these activities are combined with health checkup and professional health care at HealthCorp's facilities, clinics and hospitals. You can see how it runs, it is operated. You can see the number of HealthCorp members and branches, and they run the hospitals and clinics, and visiting nursing stations, and elderly care services, nursing homes, home helper stations, daycare centers, service houses. And elderly care business is has started since 2000. HealthCorps have increased their involvement in long-term care insurance system as a natural extension of health promotion and health care. They rapidly invested in facilities for elderly care and encouraged members to participate in health checkup, exercise, and volunteering so as to maintain good health and conduct mutual support. They became the fourth largest long-term care providers. You can see the evolution of the HealthCorps. You can see the very rapid expansion of the in-home services and community care. Of course, they have some facility run by medical corps, that is intermediary facilities between the hospitals and home. You can see the mainly they earn the, from the healthcare services, but the proportion of the social care is increasing. You can see now HealthCorp is ranked as fourth providers of elderly care. But if we combine with the consumer corps, it is ranked as the second position in the provision of elderly care. So HealthCorps had initiative to build communities based on health and medical and welfare networks before the government had started the integrated community care. And Minami Medical Corp in Nagoya has built a network of housing, medical care, long-term care, health promotion, and livelihood support. It was designated by the ministry as a model of the ICC. It has started in 1960s after the typhoon that hit this area in Nagoya that killed 5,000 lives. So that is located in the southern part of Aichi Prefecture. And now membership is around 76,000 and they have 800 employees, including doctors and nurses. And their turnover is 10 billion yen, and they have two hospitals, 10 clinics, and visiting nurse stations, etc. So they have developed the elderly care facilities since the year 2000. That is one of the very important part of this HealthCorp. And they have also invested in the housing in the co-op villages, clustering long-term care facilities, and multi-generation flats that were opened these years. So it is really a complex of facilities. You can see that I have shown five columns of the ICC, and this is what they have provided as the facilities other business entities, but that is involved. That has involved the members' activities. That is very important. Not only giving the professional services, but also the consumers are taking part in various capacities, the volunteers, and as a volunteers, and especially in the preventive service, they have more than 1,000 hand groups which learn about health and social care. So cooperatives had, okay, I shall conclude. making progress, but I shall come to the conclusion that HealthCoops presents a unique model of social innovation, combining health promotion, preventive medicine, and medical care and long-term care. The Millennium Medical Corps efforts for community building is recognized as a model of the integrated community care. Co-op builds a network of living centered on hospitals by managing mutual help in the communities. And Co-op not only operates facilities for health promotion, health care, and elderly care, but also extends activities to improve daily life. But the coordination mechanism of health and long-term care enabling normalization that helps the elderly to receive a mix of optimal services and live an active life with dignity in communities until the end of life requires to be elaborated in depth. In this case, I am now studying the Dutch model or Danish model centered on the visiting nurses for the integrated community care with great interest, and we shall develop such a model in Japan. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your inspiring speech, Professor Kurimoto. I want to relate Professor's speech to the Hong Kong situation. Japan went through two critical policy change. First, in the year of 2000, when they introduced long-term care insurance, the impact is all of a sudden the business sector is flooding into the space and providing all kind of service with the money provision from the insurance scheme. So the public sector as well as the welfare sector are shrinking very fast, but they bring in a lot of newer workforce into it and so on. But after 16 years, all of a sudden, Japanese find out the long-term care insurance make up 10% of their annual budget. They say, oh, wow, maybe we cannot afford it. So they have a lot of reform going on, and one aspect is being mentioned by Professor is the ICC integrated caring model. They integrated housing, medical care, long-term care, prevention, livelihood support into one, and the target is 2025. It's excellent. Hong Kong is still modeling after Japan. We are using CCV, community cash coupon scheme, trying to introduce more different type of player, business and social enterprise or NGOs into the space, but it's in a very slow manner. Are we able to make the change? I don't know. And while Japan's experience is already moving on, using cooperative is one of the emerging, and Professor Chong also will talk about that. Hong Kong is still thinking about how to use NGO and business, how to balance both sectors. So I think we have a lot to learn from Japan and Korean experience. So without further ado, let's hear the input and inspiring input from Professor Chong. Professor Chong is a professor at the Department of Global Public Admin at your Yonsei University. He is a very experienced scholar and leader scholar in social entrepreneurship. He organized a 2014 Social Entrepreneurship Forum in Korea, and as we all know, Korea is one of the leading innovator for innovator for solution addressing social problems. So let's give a big paw to Professor Chung.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am very honored to be here to present my research to Hong Kong audience and the people from global society. Okay, so my presentation will be focused on Korean case. We do successful two cases, and then more on the innovation strategy from they started their business to the institutionalization of their business in the local place. So I took up the two cities case, Anseong and Ansan cities, so medium and small size cities which had large old age population and then low income classes, which needs more elderly care than other places. Okay, so this content, I skipped to the many things. Well, I'm going to go fast because time limits. Okay, background. Korean welfare system has impressively developed in past four decades due to the successful industrialization and democratization. Now we have universal social insurance system, health insurance, pension, work injury, employment, also old age care, long-term care insurance. We started from 2007 following the Japanese model. So the Kumamoto's professors already many schemes of the long-term care service, which our system is very similar. Thank you to save my time. Okay, and then so as you see the brief chronology is health insurance started 1975, and then we have full coverage 1988. So almost we start quite recent time, and then we have full coverage. But we have also we have the I'm sorry, universal child care with voucher system, also long-term care also universal because of the long-term care insurance. But we have some problem with the delivery system. Okay, so we have a large size of so-called quasi non-profit and quasi market profit. The reason why I call quasi is the governmental regulations. The non-profit sectors and market sectors buying, providing subsidies and setting the prices. So competition is kind of the limited conditions. But the problem is that, you know, agency, the elderly care facilities, public agencies almost 1%. All providers are from private. So there are the major result of this the delivery system and the high competition and fragmented delivery system among the market and non-profit providers with the governmental low price setting and subsidies for the regulated service provision result in low quality of services or low working conditions for the care workers. So this is kind of the image of care service providers. State is very small. Social care sector is actually smaller than that image, but I showed you. And then we have a large size of quasi non-profit sector for yearly welfare service. But elderly care and child care, majorly a quasi market sector provide. Okay, we have the lowest fertility rate, and very fast the old aging rate. Okay, so what is social innovation? So as you already know, so I skipped this part, and then briefly define the development of implementation of new ideas and of our products, services, and models to meet social needs and create new social relationships for the collaborations. Okay, so there are many different types of the the social innovation. Okay, so what's the new role in social economic sector in the care provisions? So you know, it can be complement with the previous welfare service sectors, so social service sectors, toward better quality services and enhance solidarity and local economy. How? Reviving the local economy with the meeting welfare needs. Also providing integrative and effective welfare service to community members. And then participatory democratization through the co-production, and then creating new community culture and social capital. So I don't think the social economic sector cannot replace welfare system, only complement. But the basic idea is like this way. The social economic sector will enlarge it, and then other sectors squeeze, so kind of balance. So in Korea, as Japan, the health cooperatives started as a consumer cooperatives, but 2012, government made a law, the basic law for promoting the cooperatives. So since then, all health and care services should be social cooperatives, not consumer cooperatives. So then, since the 2012, now we have 406 social cooperatives. So fastly, you know, increasing number of social cooperatives. And this is my analytical framework. I'm more focused on stakeholder involvement strategy as a social innovation. So in the community context, we have economy, demography, history, and culture. And the left side, stakeholder involvement strategies, the need identification and identification of the stakeholder in need and interest, and the interaction. Then we can think about many different modes of the stakeholder involvement. They might be part of the social innovation strategy. And then you have a variety type of social innovation, so production level and organization level, process level, and kind of model level. Okay, so this is the, another framework to find out, identify a specific social innovation strategy from the cooperative start from their business to the institutionalizing their business in the local places. So I divided several step actors, initiators, setting social goals, startup strategies, and penetration in the established market and providers, make a relationship with stakeholders, and overcoming the barriers and expanding new roles, and then institutionalizing new roles in organization in the local sector. Okay, so I'm brought two successful cases to cities. Anseong is an urban rural complex city in the Gyeonggi province, around the Seoul metropolitan area. And then as you see, the Anseong city is fast increasing aging society, aging community. So now 13%, and then population rate is stagnated, and then now we have many foreign workers, and then married the immigration of people, and then so we have foreigners increasing that rural and then small city areas. Okay. So quickly shows that since the Anseong started their business in 1994, and then their members quickly increased, and they set the local service provider centers, and then they provide general health care, and then preventive care, kind of community activities, also elderly care. But in Korea, you know, service, healthcare, elderly care delivery system very fragmented because of the quasi-market system. So clinics and then hospitals only provide healthcare. So elderly care provided by the elderly care agencies. So they cannot combine together. But the cooperatives can integrate services from preventive services to general health care and elderly care, and then meeting the local people need from a very integrative way. Okay, so it's the, everything is increased quickly. So some short cutting of the what they're doing here. And the Ansan also similar, but it started later. But Ansan was the industrial city created by the government for the kind of cluster concept. And then so many working classes live there. And then when the medium, small size business. So as you see, the population is increased. So performance also increased. Okay. So that's the summary of the innovations, you know, each stage of the development. So Ansong was initiated the medical student activity during the democratic period. Medical student came down during the summer vacation for those provide the health service and then meet the local youth group. And then they decide to create health cooperative. And then after they graduate medical school, they came down. They set the cooperatives. Otherwise, and Ansan was set initiated by local civil movement groups and labor unions. And then, so that is the, in a sense, the civil society initiatives with the strong, you know, the good wills. And then setting their goals, as you said, providing initiative, integrative social service, and then building new communities. And then the strategy was the proper service, because healthcare, elderly care is, you know, very competitive. So healthcare is, you know, but the insurance price is very low. So overuse of treatment. And then elderly care is a low treatment, low service. So they set a strategy proper service. And then group meetings, and then building the trust with the local community members, and then increasing the membership. And then the different local members, and how to penetrate the established market providers. So they want to compete the local the market providers. They try to find the niche market that they can do better than others. So they combine oriental and medical services. Because in Korea, they regular health service market separated. And then they visiting services, healthcare, doctors, nurses visit there. Because rural area is a remote area, so people can very difficult to come to there. So also provide the group activities with preventive health education, exercise, cultural communities, so create community, you know, identities. And then how to make a relationship with the stakeholders. As I said, not compete with other service providers, but, you know, try to make a collaborate with the local government. But unfortunately to local governments in these cities, they don't, you know, they want to collaborate. But later, they building trustship. They doing good job. So in some cases, the local government made a contract with the cooperative with doing the other service. That is the one of the making networking, and how to overcoming the barriers, expanding new roles, as you say, not competing, and then educating members, and then Ahn-sung was cooperative is one of the difficulties securing medical professionals because the salary is very high, but their budget is low, so they cannot provide full the salaries to medical doctors. So many medical doctors come in and they leave. So securing medical doctors is very critical condition. But Ahn-sung was created by the medical doctors. They have a network. They have a community. So they can secure the medical doctors. And but Ahn-sung was some difficulties, but they tried to increase the salaries, trying to secure. Also, they have a relationship with the national network, and then providing some help from there. And then finally, how to institutionalize, expanding services, and then service centers, maintaining trust with local community members, and networking and alliance with other social economic organizations, NGOs, civil movement organizations, also diversifying funding sources. So at the conclusion, these two cities, the most successful case in Korea, now their services settled in the community. Okay. The conclusion is as I told you, can you read it quickly? So I want to finish my presentation. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Chung, sharing a very good experience from Ahn-sung and Ahn-sung City on the cooperative. May I invite all three speakers to be on stage? I think this year's SE Summit is really have a unique approach. We first start with a keynote speaker talking about social economy, and everyone know political economy said, okay, we have to use collective approach to address some common problem, no? So to avoid the tragedy of the common. So we talk about a lot about cooperative. And then at the closing remark, we will talk about B Corp, which is from the welfare economy, which believe rational man, hopefully out of self-interest going through market solution, they could find a solution. So it's exactly on the opposite spectrum. So let's see which one is more innovative. But allow me to also talk about cooperative a little bit. At this moment, as far as I know, there are none in Hong Kong. Yeah, I hope I will see this emerging. Hong Kong's model is more a subvented model. Government provide all the money for the NGO to deliver the service. But a lot of my friends from the NGO sector told me, how could we innovate? When the fund come, it already very specifically told us what you can do and what you can't do. So how to innovate? But elderly care is really something we need to continually searching for new solution, because the profile of the whole aging generation is different. The demand is different, the psychological need are different. And so that's why the government say, okay, let's introduce the coupon system, the consumer directed the welfare system. But is business a solution? Japan is ahead of us almost 16 years, Korea is going that. And I believe we really need to take a serious look at this cooperative approach. Yeah, instead of, I think Professor Kurimoto mentioned in your presentation, in one of your example, they trained 10,000 ordinary citizens to provide health education in the community, and that's all free. When the population profile changed from now 5 young men to 1 old people, in the future 1.5, 1.2 to 1, we cannot afford just paying for all the professionals. We need the community involvement. So I don't want to go further. I hope all of you could join us in this discussion, debate. Questions are welcome. There's two mics out there, and I hope to limit it 3 minutes each speakers. And then I will give each speaker 3 minutes to wrap around on your presentation. Who want to speak first? Oh, come on. Any language, yeah, any language, Cantonese, Mandarin, and English, are all welcome. Professor Kun. Oh. Okay, maybe I talk too much. Okay, please. Introduce Chen. Yourself. Yeah.
My name is Peggy Chen. I'm currently a director of Education for Good on a voluntary basis. Anyway, like the speakers to share experience in how what's the government role in encouraging the bottoms-up engagement in providing this healthcare, community healthcare, like how the civilian get interested and motivated to, you know, participate in such type of extensive movement, and how come Japan is so successful, and Korea, and etc. So please share your experience so that Hong Kong can see how we can enhance and promote something similar.
Thank you, Becky. How to get citizen interest in this cooperative effort? Anyone? Professor Chung?
Actually, at this time in Korea, the cooperatives are not in the past. We have the strong cooperative movement in history, but during the industrialization process, that movement was not fully developed. But since the democratization. As I told you, civil activists, rather than fighting for the government, they go to the field and then, you know, exercise their ideas, the practice. But in Korea, there is kind of the ideological conflict and the conservative policy, because of two division of the Korea. Today the government was very active to promote social economic sector, whatever the region is, but because they believe that it's very necessary to protect the people, because the government cannot do all the things. Then government made a law, 2007, the promotion of the social enterprise. 2012, the magic law for the cooperatives. Then this is tended to be make people aware. Oh, cooperative is now our common practice. We can do that. Because previously, cooperative was, we have a big government-controlled cooperative, agricultural cooperatives and other things. But that was not really cooperative as it is. Government control, but now people think about the cooperatives now kind of solution, and at the same time the mass media and then civil activities, they, you know, promote to make the people aware of this. So the situation is that bottom-up movement and top-down the promotions now meeting together, probably the if have a very good political condition to support, and then government good policy, I believe that the Korea's is social economic sector quickly expanded again. Thank you.
Well, I shall explain about the. Background of the cooperatives in Japan. There are two major sectors in Japan. One is agricultural cooperatives that have been helped and subsidized by the government and promoted by the government as very important social or economic and social organizations in the rural area. And agricultural cooperatives covers almost everything in the people's life in rural area, from supply and marketing and banking and insurance to the health and social care and even funeral services or a travel agency. So they are providing a very important infrastructure for the rural life, and they are the basic supporter of the conservative government. So they have been very much promoted by the government. I must say that is a top-down phenomenon, while the consumer sector is quite different. That is really bottom-up. There is no government support, but peoples or consumers had banded together to help themselves by developing the buying clubs or developing the health cooperatives from the bottom. And then they became a very large social and economic institution. And now still there is no help from the government. So that is truly independent. And to some extent, that is neglected by the government. So, but it's true, it's good for the cooperatives that can develop their own development path. So there is a quite distinct cooperative sectors in Japan, basically government-sponsored and neglected by the government. So in case of the agricultural cooperatives, their health care and social care operation is very much supported by the government. And as a matter of fact, the, in the rural area, agricultural cooperatives, health promotion, health services are the indispensable service. Otherwise, there is no health services in the rural area. That is very much concentrated in the urban settings. So they had been given the special status of the public healthcare provider since 1951. So they had very much have been supported by the government. While in the consumer sector, we had no such an government support. So it had developed from the bottom. Mm. But nowadays, the government had come to recognize that such an citizens' initiatives from the bottom need to be promoted so that the financial deficits, which is now culminating to the 200% of the GDP, that is worse in the world. And so now the government can't spend more money to subsidize the healthcare or social care. So now the government is supporting cooperatives or nonprofits who are providing social and health services by the way of the enactment of the long-term care insurance system in the year 2000. So now we are in the equal footing with the private sector and the public sector, and we are competing very hard to gain the consumers' support, consumers' recognition, and so in this regard, the competition is very hard, and the private sector is now dominating the non-institutional care, while the quasi-governmental sector is already still dominating the institutional care, that is long-term care, sorry, elderly care nursing home, that is now provided by mostly by the municipalities and social service corporations as quasi-governmental, quasi-non-governmental organizations. But in such a circumstances, cooperatives are providing services to compete with other nonprofits or other social economy organizations, and competing with government organizations, government-sponsored organizations. And so it's a quite different scenery, landscape we can see in the rural area and in urban area. And so everyone is now competing to support the consumers, support consumers, everyone is competing to gain the consumers' recognition so they can go to those services. So as far as the government promotion is concerned, there is no direct support for to help people to be involved in the healthcare or social care. So that is done by the non-profit organizations or cooperatives. But the government had given the very important infrastructure of the universal healthcare in 1960s and long-term care insurance system in the year 2000. So the government is giving just infrastructure, and the other for-profit, non-profit, and the governmental organizations are competing to gain the consumer support.
One question that I want to clarify. No matter who they are, whether they are public or business or NGO or cooperative, as long as they deliver the service, they are entitled to claim the long-term insurance for compensation, isn't it? Is that true?
That's true. Okay. Of course, to gain such an recognition, we have to pass through the examination by the government to be designated as qualified service providers.
I think this is a very key policy that Hong Kong is still to be introduced. Right now, majority of our service are still by subvention and by purchase scheme from the private nursing home. And Ostrom talked about separating the aggregating of demand and provision of the service separately. So you government will provide all the funding, but for example, through a cash coupon system, then whoever qualified to deliver the service after you finish, then you are entitled to get the payment. But right now, without this policy, very difficult for cooperative to start up in Hong Kong because we have no way to claim the money. So, but anyway, this is something we could learn from. Ms. Chen, you have any thought on the information platform might institute might inspire more consumer to bundle together and form cooperative and providing home care service in China?
I think we all learn from the experience from Korea and Japan. They are far ahead than China, but I take Didi as a model, as an example. Uber initiated this model, and Didi copied the model in China. And lately, Didi merged, they take over Uber China. So in a market in this size, they could grow very fast. Mm-hmm. And I think the cooperation is one key to apply the Didi model in the elderly care sector, and education is essential. It doesn't like driving. Driving is now a general skill of many people, but elderly care isn't. So if we can turn it into a more general skill, if we provide more education to ordinary people, then maybe one day we can bump up the supply side.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Comment? Yes, please. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah. Hi. Good morning. I'm Dr. Fong, a medical doctor in Hong Kong. In the next few months, we are going to roll out a new platform, a telemedicine platform, providing video consultation for elderly. Do you have any experience in telemedicine in your country?
Tele elderly care or telemedicine, could you give any comment from Korea or Japan? Consultation through video, through internet, yeah.
Yes, that is now being experimented in many places, and the government wished to introduce this scheme in a wider space, but still we are experimenting. And of course, now thanks to the development of the IT, there is a growing space for such a telemedicine, and that can help especially the rural people to get direct consultation from the doctors. But in the cities, the number of doctors is beyond the demands. So it's very difficult to run the hospitals and clinics in Japan. But in the cities that the medical healthcare services in oversupply, but in the rural area, that is shortage of supply, and especially in the remote area or islands, we need to develop such a scheme of telemedicine that is really demanding.
In Korea also, as far as I know, legally not allowed, but the government, you know, trying to push, you know, this the diagnosis and treatment with the IT technologies. But there are debate on that, what that is proper or not, because of the common medical doctors don't want to do that. But the big hospitals and the industries don't want to do that to promote the medical, you know, industries. Government also supports this. So it is the. But I believe that technology development will, you know, expand this treatment and the diagnosis. But before do that, we have to be very careful about how to use the technologies, because sometimes it might be, bad for the consumers, or because of the accuracy of the diagnosis and treatment. So many medical doctors that I know, who I know, that told about the many delicate issues, very personal issues. So the technology already not good, because technology with accompanied by proper institutions and then the examination system. That's my idea.
Thank you. Any other, in view of time, we could only allow one more question. Anyone? Yes, please.
This is Sharon. I come from Malaysia, right? I work at the University of Reading, Malaysia, as a UK university. I'm from the Henley Business School. So actually, it's not much of a question. I have a question for the speaker, actually, but I wanted to answer the doctor. Where's the doctor?
Doctor.
Now, just to share with you, right, you're talking about telemedicine. We tried that in Malaysia. Now, 7-8 years ago, I worked in the Ministry of Health as a consultant, and we tried that. Now, the problem with rural area is people are, I wouldn't want to put it not so nicely, getting on the internet or getting on the computer is something the last thing they want to do, all right? So what happened is, later on, we put up a study. We actually set up what we call One Malaysia Clinics. So these clinics are not staffed by doctor, exactly as what the speaker was saying. Like, the doctors wouldn't want to go there. The doctors don't want to be responsible for that kind of thing. So we staff, right, nurses. So we staff nurses there, nurses who wants to go back to the rural district to have their, you know, to be close to home. But they are the people who can understand medical terms, medical treatments, and they are the people who become, like I say, my doctors there. So we run that clinic, and through the last 5 years, we have opened over 100 clinics around the country.
Yep.
And they are all partly funded by the government, and it's very welcome by the community.
Thank you for the information. But do you have questions?
Yes, the question for the speakers. Now, do you see community development as a move towards developing elderly care service? Because you find, you know, a lot of time we talk about the top down and the big picture downwards, right? It's very difficult. Just in Malaysia, that we have the same scenario, that we have a different social development department, we have the economic department, they all have their own budgets. And when you approach them, just like what the our colleague here say, they have their own agenda. So if we, like I'm experimenting now in Malaysia, I take a community at one time, so I can go to the government agency, representative committee, and park my project underneath the budget. And it seems to be working right now. Will it work in your country?
Yep, thank you.
I'm sorry, I couldn't understand exactly what your question, but the Korean government is so centralized. Okay, so most of budget of the local welfare services come from central government. So actually, autonomy of the discretion of the local government is very small. All welfare service programs set by central government. And then problem is that each ministries their own programs, and then put them the local government to implement. And then sometimes the programs overlap. There are inefficiencies, not coordinated. That's the problem in the Korean delivery system. So I think we need to provide more autonomy and then budget to the local government. But there is the issue that central government not trust local government. And then the kind of things still going on in Korea. So local government, they allied together. Recently, they created the so-called social solidarity economy local government associations. So they are pushing the government, this government, the more autonomous of the local government, and then promote social economy by local government. That's the situation in Korea.
Well, as I have mentioned, integrated community care is a policy of the government, and that wish to promote such an integration of the services at the community level, rather than the top-down approach from the central government, but devolved its decision-making at the community level, or I must say the municipality level or community level, so that the people can coordinate by themselves amongst the providers so that they can make the optimal services to the patients or elderly. I have seen one example in Denmark that is based on the Dutch system of, it is called Buurtzorg in Dutch language, that is based on the visiting nurse. They are very much communicating with the doctors and the care workers and home helpers. So they need both medical side, healthcare side, and elderly care side. And of course, prevention side, they know. So those visiting nurses are playing very key role in coordinating the services, which is provided under the health insurance system and long-term care insurance system. both of them are the publicly funded, and so to say, the coupon system, voucher system, we can choose any providers, and that the money will be reimbursed from the government to the providers. Of course, we have to pay 10 to 30% of the co-payments from the patients, but the basic fund is paid by the tax and our social insurance fee. So that worked very well. But the problem is the lack of coordination at the community level. So now the government initiative of the ICC is very important. Without any funding, but the government is not just saying, please make coordination among providers. That is good. We can't build up such a system from the top. We should build up from the bottom at the community level. So in this regard, I appreciate the government proposal initiative, and every providers are now running to implement this new scheme, but without any funding for that purpose. Of course, basically, healthcare and long-term care is funded by the schemes, health insurance scheme and long-term care insurance system scheme. So I think it is really the chance for opportunities for the private sector, public sector, and cooperative sector to provide the best mix of services. So I think this is very healthy situation in which we should run our business.
In view of time, I will give each speaker another chance to speak. But keep it short, maybe 1 or 2 minutes. Maybe Professor Chong want to comment on the welfare mix?
I add something, though, you know, yeah? Even though in Korea, very centralized government, but now we see the differences in local governments. Because what I'm saying is that leadership of the local government is very important. Given the regulation and budget limit, but some local government leaders, they want to promote the community level. We see they can do. They reorganize their budget, and then they create their own programs at the community level. So we have some cases. Certain the county area, small city area, the local leaders really doing the community level jobs, and then other they're not. They are just follow the central government directions. So, given the limitations, most important thing in this time is the how local people push the government leaders, and then how we get the good the government, local government leaders.
And Ms. Chen, do you have any additional comment?
I thought the professors all contribute to how this cooperation, how the collaboration can work. And this is also the thought on the Uber model. That could be a way of cooperation. By the IT platform, by the new technology that could match the demand and supply. And the further potential is to how to explore the under-leveraged resources.
Sure.
And for achieving a synergy of all these parties.
Mm.
And I don't have the question. I don't have the answer to whether LDKR can go Uber. But I just hope we can call for further study and given some very note to the practitioner. And I believe from the organization, the micro prospect organization need a more strategic thought out on how to make this model work. And on a macro prospect, it's an institutional study, how to facilitate.
At least the technology provide a free platform for consumer to participate. Professor Kurimoto, you have anything added?
For
anything? Just to wrap up, yeah, if you have an important message to let us know what is key to innovation in elderly care. Yeah.
Yes, thank you for listening to us. And there are some kind of cooperatives which provide health care and social care. In most cases, the producer cooperatives are in the mainstream. For instance, doctors' cooperatives, social care workers' cooperatives. Please remember that there is another example of the consumer-driven cooperatives which can provide not only produce or food, but also healthcare or medical care. And in this regard, I think in Hong Kong, cooperatives is lacking. So that is, I think, wish you should develop cooperatives as a mutual help organizations to supplement the government services, to supplement, to complement the non-profit organizations. And cooperatives are located in between the government and non-profits. But it can provide you good opportunities of mutual help. That is encouraging people's participation in the provision of the social services.
As a wrap up, I would like to point out integration of all kind of service is very, very important. Right now, everything is fragmented. You go to the doctor, doctor said, okay, you have a heart decision, you go to see the heart doctor, maybe you go to see the diabetes doctor, you go to social care, so you have dementia, you go to dementia clinic, okay, you have a fall problem, you have you do physical rehab. I mean, okay, no one is really recommending a solution from the point of the elder or the seniors. So that's why integrated approach is very important, and this also related to our need to redefine what is elderly care and how does the community participate in redefining this and provision of this service. Anyway, thank you very much. And please, before you leave, fill in the questionnaires. And let's give a big round of applause to all our speakers. OK, yeah, let's have a photo together.